Welcome, we'll talk about air quality modeling today, and in this we would mainly focus on the Gaussian plume model. Now when we start with air quality monitoring, there are various sources of pollution that could be seen. It could be in a form of point, for example a pollution coming out from a vent. It could be in a source of in a source that is area, so that could be in the form of pond. It could be in the form of volume or linear. So there are various kinds of sources of pollution that could be seen. Now across all these sources of pollution, what we need to understand is, while we are doing air quality modeling, we are trying to understand or bring in mathematical models mainly to understand the emission and the quality of the air. So let's say we have a pollution source that's here. Now what would happen? The pollution would be maximum at the source that is here, and slowly and gradually it would tend to disperse, and this dispersal would follow a normal Gaussian curve. So that's how we talk about the Gaussian plume model, which explains that the air pollution that is caused or the concentration of the pollutant varies in the form of a Gaussian curve, the concentration being maximum towards the center line. So that's the basic idea of the Gaussian plume model. Now what are the input data that's being required for air source monitoring? It's mainly the characteristics of the source, the meteorological conditions and the surrounding conditions. Now when we talk about the Gaussian plume model, we say the from the vent or the from the chimney or the stack, the pollutant that comes out could be in the form of steady or could be continuous, so it would be known as steady state. On the other hand, it could be puffs, so it could come then go, then come then go, so that would be kind of puff plume that would be formed. So different kinds of plumes could be formed. What we understand under the Gaussian plume model is a steady state, where we say there is a constant rate of pollutant that is coming out. Now there are various models to understand the air quality. So you have the deterministic model, statistical model and the physical model. Today what we would be doing is only the statistical model, only the deterministic model, that is the Gaussian plume, which falls under the steady state. So what is steady state? We already talked about. So that's one of the basic assumptions that lie behind the Gaussian plume model. And then the time dependent models, the statistical and the physical models, we'll be covering in a separate lecture. Now when we talk about the Gaussian plume model, as we said, it follows a kind of Gaussian curve or a normal curve. So let's say I have a vent here. Now from this vent you have the air or the pollutant that goes out. Now in which direction it should go? So it would follow the direction of the vent. So first of all, if this is the overall space, this pollutant would go in the direction of the vent. Now when it is following the direction of the vent, there could be three axes along which it would follow. So one is the vertical or the z axis. The next is the downwind direction, which is the direction across which the wind is blowing, and that is basically affected by the wind speed. And then you have the other y-axis that we would understand, that would be the xy plane in which the pollutant is basically flowing. So that's the basic idea. Now when I say the pollution is going from this point, okay, when this pollution is going or the concentrate is going from this point, what would happen is, if this is the direction of the wind, it would spread like this, and when it is spreading like this, the maximum concentration would be along the center, and then it would follow the Gaussian curve. When I'm saying it would follow the Gaussian curve, its peak would be highest always at the center, and there would be lateral dispersion by along the axis, y axis, that would be seen. So along the yz axis there would be lateral dispersion that would be seen, and the maximum concentration would always be in the direction of the wind. So that's the main idea to understand this Gaussian plume model. Now why do we apply this Gaussian plume model? We try to find out the concentration of a pollutant, of the pollutant at a particular place, and that's why we apply this Gaussian plume model. Where this model cannot be applied is also important. It cannot be applied in the case where pollutants are facing chemical transformations. So if there are chemical transformations, we cannot apply this model exactly. Now, how do we understand or derive exactly as to how much concentration would be there. So for that, we have some mathematical formulas that we try to understand. Before that, let's have a kind of a small idea about the effective stack height. So what is stack? So stack is basically a point lying above the ground from where you have the emission. Now, I can say the taller the stack, the better it is. Why? Because the taller the stack, it would have more dispersion area, and since it would have more dispersion area, the concentration of the pollutant would be much more dispersed or diluted in the atmosphere. So what you have, the stack height, and then you have the plume rise, that's the rise in the amount of the fumes that is matching to the center of the plumb line, and together this plumb rise along with the stack height gives you the effective stack height. Now this plumb rise is usually 0.2 to 0.6 of the original stack height. So that's how we understand this effective stack height. We'll be talking about this stack height in more detail as we move forward. Now for this, we have some presumptive assumptions that we try to make. Now, assumptions under this Gaussian plume model are very, very important. The first assumption, as we said, is the steady state. So, steady state, that means there is the rate of constant emission that could be seen. Homogeneous flow, that means the wind speed is constant, both in terms of the speed and the height. The pollutant is taken as conservative. There is no gravity fallout that is seen. The terrain is considered as flat. Okay, there is perfect reflection. Now this perfect reflection we would understand in a while as we would move forward with deriving the formula for the concentration of the pollutant. And then the turbulent diffusion in the x-axis is neglected. So what we understand basically is this concentration moves along with the wind speed. Now there could be a stable condition and an unstable condition. The unstable condition would have a lot of turbulence that would be seen, and more the turbulence, more unstable the conditions would be. So that's some of the factors that affect it. And then you have, since we are saying it's moving in the x direction or the direction of the wind, it's basically following the advection. And therefore, advection becomes one of the major factors that affect the Gaussian plume model. Now, let's start with deriving the concentration that could be seen in the XYZ plane. So, as we said, there are three axes, the Z axis, X axis along which you have the wind that is flowing, and you have the y-axis. So you have three planes that we are understanding, and within this three plane we are trying to understand the concentration of the pollutant. So first of all, we would find out the concentration in terms of y-axis and z-axis. So when we are trying to find out the concentration in terms of y-axis and z-axis, we have the following formula that would be there. Now based on this, what we try to do is we try to find out the concentration in the yz plane. So it's moving in the x-axis, and the concentration in the y-axis would be given by this formula. Now when I'm saying yz axis, then this z axis, which is a vertical axis, would have the stack height. So what I take into account in the second point is the height of the stack that would be considered. So height of the stack, when I am trying to consider that, I am doing a formula that's simple, that is z minus h. So what we are doing is here I am considering the height of the chimney or the height of the stack. Now once you have the height of the stack, consider that if this height is infinity, then it won't be able to touch the ground, and you would have all pollution that would be dispersed into the atmosphere. But in this case, our height is not infinity. We have a certain height. That means from this height, it would hit the ground and reflect back. So there would be a kind of reflection that would be seen, and to understand this reflection, we take a kind of inverse phenomena that could be seen, or a reflection of this that could be seen, and we calculate this with the following formula, and this is considered as the final equation for understanding the Gaussian plume model. Now this final equation is important because sometimes there are direct questions that are put up on this basis. Now based on this, let's understand if I remove certain criteria. So from this formula, let's say I remove Z, what would happen is, I'm not talking about the vertical Z axis. Now what would happen here is, I'm talking about the XY plane. So I'm talking about everything that's on the ground. So it could be crops, it could be human beings. So XY plane is the plane I'm considering. And when I'm considering this plane, my formula comes out to be this. I'm ignoring the Z component. So this becomes my formula. Now in the case, I'm taking only the Z direction. That's the direction of the wind that is flowing. What would happen? My formula would turn out to be this, because my Y and Z become zero. And when my Y and Z become zero, this would be the concentration that could be seen. So concentration along x-axis when Y and Z are zero would be represented by this formula. Again, the maximum concentration occurs when the standard deviation of Z is h by root 2. So that's again important. So sometimes there are direct questions, as we said, on these sections. Now, what is important to understand is, let's go back to that formula that we had. So this was our final formula, and here we had calculated the standard deviation of Z and standard deviation of Y. Now this standard deviation of Z and standard of deviation of Y varied with the direction of X. However, when we are trying to find out the concentration of the pollutant, we have three unknown variables with us, which are standard deviation of Y, standard deviation of Z, and the plume rise. So what we need to understand is to calculate these three. Once we have these three, we can calculate the concentration. Now how do we calculate the standard deviation of Y and Z? So standard deviation of Y and Z are calculated by the intensities, and these are known as the turbulence intensities. So I take IY and IZ and I multiply it with X. So I get the standard deviation for Y and standard deviation for Z, and this is what is my turbulence intensity is. So turbulence intensity becomes important in understanding the or finding the standard deviation of Y and Z. Now these turbulence intensities are given by this formula, where ln is the log natural, hs is the height of the chimney or the stack, and z0 is basically the aerodynamic roughness that represents different topographical conditions that could be seen in that region. So with this, I find the turbulence intensity. Now once I have the turbulence intensity, I can explain this turbulence intensity with the following graphs or the following ways. That means when I'm saying from the stack, you have the emission that's going on. It's not necessarily in a linear fashion where I say this is the cross-section area that's covered and the maximum concentration is here. As you move towards the periphery, the concentration decreases. But the conditions would change with the environment. So there would be condition where the environmental lapse rate is greater than adiabatic lapse rate, which is this, and here what would happen is you would have a looping emission that would be seen. So you would have the looping emission that would be seen. Now here you have the environmental lapse rate which is greater than adiabatic lapse rate, and hence you have a unstable atmospheric condition. Now this is again one of the direct questions that are asked in this section. So you have unstable atmospheric conditions under looping, you have stable atmospheric conditions under coning, and so on. So these are again important. Sometimes there are direct questions where you have the shape of the exhaust or the concentrate that is flowing into the atmosphere that is drawn. So this is looping, coning, fanning, trapping, fumigating, and lofting. There are six different versions or varieties that could be seen based on the turbulence intensity. Now we have found out the turbulence intensity. The other thing we need to understand is the plume rise. Now as we said, this plume rise is basically the height that we would understand, and this plume rise is governed by two factors, that is the buoyancy force and the momentum force. Now what's the difference between the two? When I say momentum force, what does it mean? It's basically governed by the velocity or the speed of the exhaust and the mass of the pollutant. So that governs your momentum force, that affects your plume rise, and next is the buoyancy force that is caused due to differences in the density. Now when it's buoyancy force, the plume rise varies with x raised to power 2 by 3. However, when it is momentum force, it varies with x raised to power 1 by 3. Now these two are again the direct things that are asked in your question. Now what is plume rise? Is basically the path or the trajectory of the plume center line that would take, and that's basically attained from the stack height. So you have HS and you have delta H, and together you have the effective stack height that is taken into consideration. So here what we do is we have two formulas, one for the momentum flux and other for the buoyancy flux. Now let's talk about the momentum flux first. So what would happen if we are considering only and only momentum in the stable and the neutral conditions? What would happen? My plumb rise would be 3dW by U, where D is the diameter of the source, W is the initial vertical velocity, and U is the wind speed, and I calculate the plumb rise. However, on the other hand, what would happen is you would have a condition where you have to find out the buoyancy. So when you are calculating the plumb rise for the buoyancy flux that's given, so this plumb rise or the concentration here would be basically function of F raised to 1 by 3, and that's again important. So that's a kind of direct question that is asked from these formulas. So under unstable condition this would be the case, and under stable condition this would be the formula. So what you all need to take away from this lecture is the major formulas, how we came on to deriving these formulas, what we are exactly trying to do. We are trying to see the concentration of the pollutant that's going in the direction of the wind, and it's not spreading across the whole area, so it's mainly predominantly following the direction of the wind. What are the limitations and what are the assumptions? So sometimes assumptions are also important, and you have direct questions that are asked on the assumption. And the one very important question that can come from this section is the various types that we have understood here. How, if the environmental lapse rate is greater than the adiabatic lapse rate, you have an unstable condition, and under unstable conditions you would have looping that would take place. So all these six graphs and the change of environmental lapse rate and the adiabatic lapse rate that would follow are very, very important to understand. You have numerous numericals that come from this section, so if you know the formulas well, you can definitely apply those. A lot of extract we have tried to understood from Western University handouts from Canada, so courtesy to them. Stay tuned for more updates. Have a great day.